A warm good afternoon, everyone. We welcome you for our hyperuricemia webinar today on behalf of Abbott. I am Dr. Pragadish Bharati from Abbott Medical Team. Here we have a presenter today, our Dr. J. Balasubramaniam, sir. He's an eminent doctor practicing for last more than 25 years as a senior consultant nephrologist, and he is one of the leading nephrologists in the country with lots of achievements and awards. He's a nationally recognized figure in area of dialysis, kidney transplantation, and prevention of kidney failures. He is the director and chief nephrologist, Kidney Care Center, Galaxy Hospital, Tirunelveli, Tamil Nadu. He's an educational ambassador to International Society of Nephrology and an adjunct professor in Dr. MGR Medical University, Tamil Nadu. He's an examiner for MRCP UK examination in South India. He's the founder trustee of Tirunelveli Kidney Foundation, and he's a member of advisory committee for cadaver transplant in Government of Tamil Nadu. Doctor has done extensive clinical research covering various aspects of kidney disease. He has n number of publications as articles, review journals, and rare case reports in various national and international journals. He is an Young Investigator Award from Tank Foundation, Japanese Society of Dialysis Therapy, and Doctor's research paper has published in international journals like Lancet, JAPI, and so on. And he is a renowned national and international speaker. He has also made his considerable efforts in educating medical practitioners and students, and has written various chapters in nephrology books. We welcome you both, sir. It's a pleasure for us to have you on board and to hear from your expertise on hyperuricemia on Indian context. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pragadish. Good afternoon, the people who have joined the webinar today. And I should really thank you, you know, for sparing time. You know, just nearly we are coming to the end of the COVID lockdown, and you'll be already, you know, bombarded with so many webinars, and I know you'll be saying no to any more webinars, but at least one thing is, we are not going to talk about COVID. It is going to be something about uric acid. Among so many ions and substances in the body, uric acid is generally not given the actual importance it deserves. That is what I used to feel. See, as a nephrologist, urea, creatinine, and as physicians, lipids, and other and electrolytes like potassium, sodium, which are all very imminently dangerous to the people. So we are very, very much aware, and we often talk about them. But uric acid is somehow has not been discussed as much as the other substances. So let us try to look at uric acid metabolism and how it affects people, and as nephrologists and as physicians, how we should be, you know, be aware of certain things. And let us try to discuss this over the next 30-40 minutes today. We know that uric acid is the end result of purine breakdown, and purine, we get it mostly from the tissue breakdown from the body, and the meat and other substances which we eat. And this purine metabolism mainly occurs in the liver by the presence of xanthine oxidase. It is also to a certain extent present in the intestine, but the major metabolism happens in the liver. And under normal circumstances, there is a very fine balance and between intake and output, and the levels are maintained in a very optimal status. And you know that uric acid, and there is a difference between uric acid and urate anions, and generally in the blood we have a circulation of urate anion and not uric acid, because uric acid is potentially, you know, crystallizable, and so it is urate anion which is in the circulation. And how much is circulating and how much is in the urate anion form, on the how much is in the uric acid form, depends on the serum urate solubility, and we'll see something about that. And any imbalance in this leads to deposition of uric acid in the tissues, leading to problems like gout and other organ dysfunctions in the kidney and other organs. So between uric acid and urate, we should understand that uric acid is a very weak organic acid. It is very poorly soluble and tendency for crystallization is, whereas this urate anion is very soluble. And any acid will have a function called pKa, which is a constant. It is the solubility factor. And any acid with a very low figure of this pKa is a very strong acid. And anything more than 7, it is a very weak acid. And this uric acid is 5.75 in the blood and around 5.35 in the urine. So it is fairly, in a balanced form. And whenever the base, if it is in the blood, when the pH is 7.4, it is maintained very statically around 7.4. The reaction is shifted to the extreme right, and it is always the urate anion, which is very soluble and it is in the circulation. When the system becomes acidic, as the pH comes down, then there is a tendency for uric acid crystals formation. And blood, we know it can't go below 7.2, but in the urine, you can always have a low pH and there will be tendency for crystallization. And let us see how this uric acid is derived from purine. See, this purine, we get it from recycling of cells every day in our body. There is millions of cells dying, and the breakdown of these cells and the DNA breakdown is the major source for these purines. And they are the adenosine monophosphate, adenosine, inosine, and glucosamine monophosphate. So all this go on to produce adenosine, inosine, and guanosine, and then to hypoxanthine and guanine, and that is where that they are transformed to xanthine. And xanthine oxidase is the very critical enzyme which converts xanthine to uric acid and urate anion, depending on the solubility factor. So this is the metabolic pathway of purine in our metabolism in our body. And as a nephrologist and as physicians, important thing is uric acid stimulates smooth muscle cell proliferation. And that smooth muscle cell in the vascular wall is a very important structure. And in the kidney, it induces the preglomerular vasoconstriction and microvascular disease and leading out to interstitial inflammation. So all this combined to form increase in salt sensitivity of the body. So uric acid is very much related to the salt sensitivity. And once somebody has very much high salt sensitivity, they are prone for raising their BP or hypertension. Then what else can this uric acid do? Besides salt sensitivity, we see that it can increase the fat storage and lead to, by leading to lipogenesis. So these are all the ill effects of uric acid. And this endothelial dysfunction and the vasoconstriction is detrimental not only to the kidney, but the whole vascular system and the many organ structures of the body. And over time, all these functional changes lead to structural deformity of the vasculature. And beyond a point, even if the uric acid level is reduced, the hypertension persists. And this we have seen hyperuricemia during pregnancy and in early life in youngsters, there we found that it is an independent risk factor for hypertension. So this is a molecule which is responsible for blood pressure in our body to a certain extent. Then what happens to uric acid in other animals? See, we are left with uric acid because xanthine oxidase is the last enzyme we have, and beyond uric acid, it is not digestible, it is not metabolizable. But what happens to uric acid in other animals and organisms? See, uric acid is converted to allantoin by uricase in other mammals. And uricase is very soluble and it is easily excreted. And in further, in even earlier animals like fish and amphibians, this allantoin and allantoic acid is converted to urea and glyoxylate. So, urea is very soluble, it doesn't crystallize. We excrete plenty of urea, so they have no problem in excreting urea. And there are further, ancient organisms like invertebrates and crustaceans, whom they have some urease, which is the enzyme which can digest urea and make it to ammonia and carbon dioxide, which can be excreted much easily. So if only we had all these enzymes in our system, like uricase, allantoinase, and urease, we probably might have been better off. We would have been excreting uric acid like nothing, and converting them to urea and urease, and we may not be having problem with urea either. But that was not supposed to happen, because very ancient time in our evolution, uricase got lost from our system. But it is a fact that uricase in different species, be it a very, you know, fish or even animals before that, they all have similar molecular weight, and they all seem to have common evolutionary origin. And on the course of evolution, we seem to have lost it, you know, nearly 15 million years ago. And so why we lost it? Generally, anything happens in evolution over time, it is for the advantage of the organism. Then only it can survive. That is the Darwinian hypothesis of survival of the fittest. So these mutations happen to make it more fit. Then only it can survive. Otherwise, that organism would have been lost forever. So this uric acid, which is being easily metabolized and lost in other organisms, or you know, left over in our body, and we are made to suffer or enjoy the presence of uric acid. And apparently we see that it increases BP and it causes problem, precipitation and stones, etc. But why did it happen in evolution? And this evolutionary change should have been for some advantage, because our kidney is reabsorbing 90% of the filtered uric acid. So leave alone the uric acid, I mean absence of uricase, if all the filtered uric acid is lost in the urine, we wouldn't be having so much of uric acid in our body. All these lesser animals have less than 1 milligram per DL, whereas we have at least 3 to 6 milligram per DL. So that should be some reason why this evolution made us to retain uric acid in our system by getting this uricase lost. I'm very fond of, in many of my talks, I bring in Dr. Homer Smith, who is a very, very renowned renal physiologist. And the great thing about him is he studied renal physiology going back to evolution, and he tried to explain physiology through evolution and explain evolution and the progression of evolution through the renal changes which took place over the millions and millions of years. See, and he has written very fantastic books like Fish to Philosopher, which stands to, you know, our interest even today. Although physiology keeps changing so quickly, but his rationalization of many things, the changes in our body, is so wonderful. I wish, you know, many of you can get this book, Fish to Philosopher, and try to see how he looked at evolution of the organisms, and how kidney probably was the system which was responsible for this evolutionary advancement. At each stage, it adapted. When other organ systems were there, following suit, but kidney was the one which was making the organism possible to evolve and reach a stage what we are now. We all started from unicellular organism from the sea, we know, from a salty environment. From there, the life started, and we have advanced to seawater living organisms, to fresh water, then fresh water to terrain, dry terrain, and started getting into areas where there was no water. So the need, our external environment was changing over this evolutionary period, and we could survive, life could survive, just because the kidney could evolve and adapt to the situations. And we talk about evolution and changes in our diet, and we try to look at people, and we only go just as beyond as the Paleolithic period. So this is a graph telling you how we have changed our diet, you know, from Paleo man, and now we know it is very fashionable for people to follow Paleo diet. But these are all things which happened over 10,000 years or so, but we are talking about this loss of uricase and how uric acid started accumulating in our body, which happened 15 million ago, years ago, and which is much earlier problem. And there are very many very nice articles which can stimulate us on evolution and, you know, uric acid, why it got lost and how we have made an advantaged organism because of that. And a summary from going through all this, the possible answer to this riddle of why we lost this: the sodium content in the food taken by our ancient people, so we can't even call them man, you know, it was very low. Even in the Paleolithic period, it was as low as 3 grams per day. They were taking, they were hunter-gatherers, and they were taking vegetables, and they were eating a lot of meat. And these things contain some amount of salt, and they were even actually better off than earlier organisms. And, you know, like apes, and before that, when they were quadrupeds, their diet contained very low sodium, less than 2 grams or 1 gram. And and they were vegetarians. So, and this was called the Miocene epoch or period, much earlier than the Paleo period. And they were eating only fruits and leaves. But soon, as evolution progressed from a quadruped situation, they became biped. They started getting up, getting this upright posture. So then they were in a miserable position because BP had to be risen to maintain the circulation to the brain. So some change had to happen, and that was where nature or God thought that we need uric acid, and this uricase was lost from our system by mutation, or the genes responsible for this became silent. And with the vasoreactive properties of uric acid, slowly we started picking up blood pressure. So low salt diet led to loss of uricase by the mutation, then uric acid increase, which led to activation of renin-angiotensin system, and caused structural changes to the vascular smooth muscles in the kidney and other organs. So then all this led to sodium reabsorption, increase in blood pressure, increased salt sensitivity, and our BP got higher than other structures. That made us, you know, able to stand up and be like what we are today. And it is not only the BP and enabling us to, you know, stand up, there were other advantages they noted. Uric acid is known to be a powerful antioxidant, and that could have been a reason why our life expectancy is, you know, getting higher compared to most of the other animals. And uric acid could be the, you know, reason for that, one of the reason for that. And and periods of very low salt ingestion during you know, this evolution, this uric acid presence helped to maintain the BP. And also there is an interesting hypothesis that uric acid level could be one reason for higher intelligence in humans. Actually, there are some studies which show even among the population now presently, people with gout and high uric acid level, their IQ is more than the general population. But this is subject to question. But there's an intelligent hypothesis like that. Higher the uric acid, more intelligent you are. And it also seems to protect us from a lot of neurodegenerative diseases. And so that is interesting because Alzheimer's and other neurodegenerative disorders are a big issue now. And maybe, you know, this uric acid is helping us from getting this degenerative diseases. So it may not be very wise to blindly, you know, try to reduce uric acid and get into other problems. So from there, we will go on to, you know, to look up at uric acid, it is levels and what is there in population, how we should be managing, etc. And again, there is no universally accepted definition of hyperuricemia because the ideal level is not known, because there is a physiochemical definition, because the pKa I talked about for uric acid to remain as acid, I mean urate, and not as acid to make prevent it from crystallization, there is a level. And in the population, you know, when you take a large sample, again the average population, that is a different level. So the levels are different. So let us try to see now. The reason is, when you see check uric acid in thousands and millions of people, the distribution is very not normal. It's a non-normal distribution in population. And by the physiochemical definition, the limit should be 7. So anything more than 7, you know, somebody will be in a danger of precipitation of uric acid crystals. So 7 could be the physicochemical definition of an ideal level. And but when you check the population, you see that there are quite a number of patients, say nearly 8% in whites and nearly 25% in East Asians, who are more than 7 in normal population, who are, you know, 2 standard deviation away from the mean. So that means when you take 7 as cutoff, there will be many people who are more than 7 and who will be unnecessarily put to various forms of treatment. So by population prevalence, you know, one has to be aware of this high prevalence of people who are more than 7. And we all know that now we are worried about uric acid and metabolic syndrome and the relationship of uric acid to hypertension, stroke, renal disease, etc. And what is the level beyond which we are more risky and below which we are less risky? Again, there is another level, because there are people who have lower level, lower than 7, around 6 or less, who are more prone for all these metabolic disorders. So the ill effects of uric acid, as far as system problem is concerned, can happen in subsaturating levels. So now with all this into consideration, the physicochemical definition, the population definition, and the ill effects like other systemic involvement. So we can say that 6 milligram could be a reasonable clinical definition for a cutoff, because if somebody has a problem like a gout or uric acid stone or some other problem, we try to bring it below 6. And for cardiovascular risk calculation, for remission from gouty arthritis, it is always 6. So for a clinical definition, we can take 6 as a cutoff. And there are more issues into uric acid level. We have different types of estimation of uric acid, enzymatic and the calorimetric method. You should keep in mind that labs which do enzymatic method, there can be 1 milligram higher than calorimetric estimation, because you know, from doctor to doctor, from lab to lab, when they come, you'll have to keep this issue in mind. And there is a gender difference also. Males have very much higher body pool of uric acid and urinary excretion. And that is probably because of the estrogenic protection given to women, especially in their period when they are fertile. That is the time their uric acid is kept low. They are protected from many diseases, you know, from cardiac and other things during that period. And uric acid is also found lower in them. And also you should keep in mind that somebody with gout, you see that uric acid level is, when active disease is there, you find that uric acid level is not high. You may be perplexed by that. This is because when there is crystal deposition, the body pool measurements can underestimate the urate pool. So these are the other issues you'll have to keep in mind when trying to sort of define the uric acid level and do something in a particular patient. So when you consider these factors in mind, you'll have a large pool of patients who have higher levels but absolutely asymptomatic. This is called asymptomatic hyperuricemia. The issue is, what do you do to these patients? Are you going to treat them? Are you going to observe them? So there is another issue being discussed these days. So they have no symptoms, but they may have some signs and findings when you evaluate them. And we know that there are many disorders like hypertension, CKD, cardiovascular disease, the metabolic syndrome and insulin resistance, who may be having in this, they may be, you know, in this pool of asymptomatic hyperuricemia. But do we treat them actively? Treating those diseases is one thing. Trying to bring down uric acid is another thing, whether it is warranted or not. But presently, we do not use urate lowering drugs for treating such conditions. Just because they are hypertensive, you don't try to bring the uric acid lower than 7 or 6. So what is the algorithm followed in these patients? You evaluate patients who are having uric acid more than 8 and they are asymptomatic. You do some evaluation, a thorough history, physical examination, and some laboratory testing. you know, you don't aggressively test them, you do this, and you clinically look for tophi, gouty tophi and urinary stone, because these patients may be asymptomatic, they might be having these signs or problems inside. So you can identify them. And also in this group of patients, you'll have to look for potentially treatable causes. So like causes which can lead to hyperuricemia, like lymphoproliferative and myeloproliferative disorders, where there are plenty of cell death and increased production of purine and increased uric acid level. Psoriasis, where the skin epithelial cells are lost in large quantities. Vitamin B12 deficiency, preeclampsia, lead toxicity is one situation where uric acid can be high. And there are many drugs which can induce hyperuricemia. So in these asymptomatic hyperuricemia, you look for these factors, and if you find any of them, try to treat them. If not, trying to use uric acid lowering drugs. Now, this is very important, because physicians will be handling all the situations in your day-to-day practice, but keep this in mind. And you give them lifestyle modification, you modify their diet so that they don't take a lot of purine containing food. And when they are medicated for some other reason, they may be having diabetes, hypertension, things like that. So when you choose drugs, you be careful to avoid drugs which can elevate the uric acid. And you can, you know, it's a nice idea to select drugs which have some inherent property to reduce uric acid also. So that is an intelligent way of approaching this problem. And physicians should be aware of drugs which can raise uric acid and which can reduce uric acid. Which could be drugs which reduce could be a good pleomorphic effect, which can help you to guide you to select the drug. And you can estimate the uric acid excretion by fractional excretion or by 24-hour collection. If it is more than 1000 milligram per liter, they would need medication, even if they are not symptomatic. So these are the methods. How do you deal with this asymptomatic patients? And this is the list of drugs which can increase the uric acid. We know that diuretics like thiazides and even loop diuretics can increase uric acid. Aspirin in even low doses can increase uric acid. And nicotinamide, niacin, a supplement, can be a cause. And as nephrologists and other rheumatologists, we use calcineurin inhibitors like cyclosporine and tacrolimus, which can increase uric acid level. Sometimes we estimate uric acid as a sort of a marker for high levels or toxicity of these immunosuppressive drugs. And levodopa, in Parkinson patients. And also importantly, ATT, anti-tubercular drugs, which many of you will be using. Be careful, keep in mind that pyrazinamide and ethambutol can be a cause for rising uric acid. And of course, patient on cytotoxic chemotherapy for all those lymphoproliferative disorders because of the rapid cell death and release of purines and uric acid, one should be careful. And the fructose, which is there in fruits and a lot of food supplements, and xylitol, again, a lot of food supplements and sugar replacement substance, keep in mind that these things can raise uric acid. So in a naive patient and in a asymptomatic hyperuricemic patient, keep all these drugs in mind. And also better to know about some drugs which can reduce uric acid. Forget about uricosuric agents and xanthine oxidase inhibitors, which are used to treat hyperuricemia. But just keep in mind that there are some antidiabetic drugs which can reduce uric acid, which can be utilized as a pleomorphic effect, and it can make you choose any of them. Gliptins. Linagliptin and teneligliptin can reduce uric acid. It could be an advantageous factor to consider. And also now we see that SGLT2 inhibitors also can reduce uric acid. And losartan and fenofibrate, when used for lipid lowering, you'll have to keep in mind that this can bother the uric acid level. So these are studies for dapagliflozin, teneligliptin, linagliptin, which have shown that there can be some reduction in uric acid level. Then moving on to hyperuricemia, is there any cause which we can find and treat? So one thing is high intake or defect in metabolism. These are the two pathways. And high intake, we don't take purines straight, but high meat containing food, protein containing food can lead to hyperuricemia. And the major site of urate production is in the liver, I told you. And degradation of this dietary part of the purine load is also important, because people have found that purine-free formula diet can reduce urinary excretion of uric acid by 40%. So it is a good idea to give them, you know, don't assume that these people are prone for hyperuricemia and leave them alone, but rationalize their high intake of purines. And there are some defects in purine metabolism which can cause hyperuricemia, but they are very rare, very uncommon, and we need not go into much detail about them. One is HPRT deficiency causing Lechnigan syndrome, which is a genetically transferred inherited disease seen in males, and most of them are wheelchair prone and they are sick. And there are other situations like phosphoribosyl pyrophosphate, PRPP synthetase overactivity, again causing increased uric acid. And in a type of glycogen storage disorder, type 1, again, there is extensive degradation of ATP to ADP and AMP, and which we know is the starting point for purine and purine metabolism. So all these are very rare, but just keep in mind, when somebody has resistant hyperuricemia and they have other features, other genetic features or congenital abnormality, keep this in mind. Then disposal has to be either gastrointestinal or the kidney. Kidney is the major route. One third is by the gut. And gastrointestinal tract, again, you keep in mind that the urate efflux, whatever is got into the gut, excreted into the gut, has to be degraded by gut flora. So it is a good idea to have good gut flora intact to facilitate the disposal of uric acid through the gut. And there are some transporters and a problem which we need not go into detail now. And as far as kidney is concerned, as I already told you, it is freely filtered, but we are reabsorbing most of them by the proximal tubule, and there is some secretion also back to the body. So this is what has made us to think that we have some evolutionary advantage in doing this, because we could have as well filtered and lost this uric acid, but our tubules are straining to reabsorb them. And the pathways used at the apical membrane and the basolateral membrane, you have URAT1 and OAT10 as anion exchangers. And interesting thing is, this anion exchanges, see? So you see that once from the apical membrane, which has to enter the cell for reabsorption, it has to be exchanged with some other anion. So these anions are those lactate, butyrate, nicotinate, salicylate, pyrazinamide things. And these are the mechanisms by which these substances are involved in uric acid balance. And and concentration of these anions should be there to facilitate this exchange at the luminal level. And besides this absorption and excretion, there are other regulation of serum urate levels, like the volume status. So it is a common knowledge that whenever somebody is fluid overloaded, their uric acid level will be low. When there is volume depletion, there will be rise in uric acid. And also, how we diagnose SAADH, inappropriate ADH secretion, although they may not be very extensively volume overloaded, their uric acid will be low. There is a diagnostic feature, there's uric acid and volume status. Similarly, salt balance. So if somebody is salt depleted, uric acid level will be high. And again, we know that insulin appears to reduce the excretion of urate. Again, so hyperinsulinemia, due to type 2 diabetes or other causes in metabolic syndrome, insulin resistance could be the reason for reduced fractional excretion and high levels of uric acid. And similarly, PTH, that could be the reason in CKD, where parathormone levels are high. And again, interestingly, the cytokine stimulated urticaria. So that is, I was telling you, in gout flare, when there is, when somebody has a, you know, very active gout, you sometimes see that their uric acid level is low. That is because this cytokine excess in their body can stimulate urticaria and reduce the uric acid level, which is a false indicator. So coming to kidney disease, uric acid and renal disease, it could be acute or chronic. And acute is called acute uric acid nephropathy. It is a sudden excessive uric acid in the tubules, which causes an oliguric or an anuric type of renal failure. This often happens in lymphoma, leukemia, or myeloproliferative diseases who are put on chemotherapy. You know, they have a load of uric acid entering the tubules, and they lead to acute renal failure. So this is suspected whenever the uric acid level is more than 10 or 15 and they have acute renal failure. And urine analysis can show uric acid crystals. So a good laboratory should be able to pick up uric acid crystals. And the estimation of uric acid to creatinine ratio in the urine can also help us diagnose this acute uric acid nephropathy. And this is best way is to prevent it by IV hydration whenever you expect uric acid nephropathy by sudden load of uric acid. You preemptively hydrate them well and use drugs, xanthine oxidase inhibitors, and try to keep their levels lower so that they don't get renal failure. And you treat them with febuxostat, allopurinol, or rasburicase. And to wash out the obstructed system, you can use diuretics, and many a times you would require hemodialysis also. And interestingly, you are not supposed to use soda bicarb at this time, because it is a general habit is to use soda bicarbonate along with allopurinol or febuxostat when dealing with these people who have this cell lysis syndrome, tumor lysis syndrome. But in the early period, particularly in the patient who does not have metabolic acidosis, this can increase the risk of other precipitation like calcium phosphate rather than uric acid. So, you know, don't blindly start them on soda bicarb without checking the pH. The other entity is chronic urate nephropathy. So this is, slowly evolving problem. Sodium urate crystals in the medullary interstitium leading to fibrosis and a chronic renal failure. And this is not easy to diagnose, actually, because this will look like any other CKD, and urate level is generally raised in CKD, so you may not be rattled by a high level in a CKD patient and think about chronic urate nephropathy. So it is difficult to separate, and only sometimes renal biopsy gives us this diagnosis. And in a given case of CKD, so it is not uric acid which causes the disease, but in a case of CKD, hyperuricemia itself is a risk factor for progression of renal disease. So that has been an important thing which we realize now. So in managing conservatively CKD patients, we try to reduce uric acid because we see that it sort of aggravates or speedens up the progression of the CKD. And the prevalence of raised uric acid in CKD is quite high, nearly 20 to 25%. And we also know that hyperuricemia could be a risk factor for other metabolic diseases like diabetes and hypertension, and these diseases can lead to renal failure. So ultimately, it is always a good idea to keep the uric acid level in an optimal or a low level in CKD patient. And also, you should keep in mind that even in asymptomatic and non-renal patient, when uric acid is high, especially in gout patients, it is better to check renal function periodically. And what does our KDIGO guideline for renal patients say? Uric acid levels are strongly and consistently associated with CKD and cardiovascular disability in various observational studies, and reduction in uric acid level can lead to improvement in blood pressure control and by retarding the progression of CKD. There are many elegant studies proving this. And from acute urate nephropathy to chronic nephropathy, then uric acid nephrolithiasis, which is one frequently seen by practitioners. This is, you know, 5 to 10% of renal stones are due to uric acid. But in a very hot and arid climate, it could be much higher than this. And whenever the urinary pH is persistently low, so that is a very risk factor. I told you about the pKa and this acid uric acid to urate equation becomes adverse when the pH is low. So it is a good idea to alkalinize the urine and keep it less prone for crystallization and stone formation. Then what about other metabolic diseases which we are worried about and their relationship to uric acid? You know, we see that type 2 diabetes, nearly 25% of them have raised uric acid, and metabolic syndrome as high as 50%, and obesity and hypertension. So this combination with you know, with uric acid is very prevalently seen. And the relationship with this uric acid and these metabolic diseases, we are not very sure whether this is the cause or a consequence or a coincidence. So this debate has been going on for some time, but now there is being a shift in our belief, and from a paradigm of causative association of hyperuricemia with cardiovascular and renal disease, from our old suspicion and skepticism, and now we see that there is more evidence to tell us that there is a true relationship. So the importance of uric acid is becoming more important as far as this metabolic diseases and metabolic syndrome is concerned. And cardiovascular disease and hyperuricemia, there are a lot of supportive studies telling us that there is a direct relationship, and uric acid as a risk factor for myocardial infarction and stroke. We have large studies telling that, you know, it is a risk factor. And surprisingly, regarding uric acid and diabetes, there are controversial reports. Is there a link between uric acid and diabetes? Reasonably there should be, because we saw that insulin and insulin resistance itself can lead to reduced uric acid excretion and higher level. And as a part of metabolic syndrome, this could lead to diabetes. And hyperuricemia by causing micro and macrovascular complications, which are the major problem in later years of diabetes. So it is a good idea to, you know, keep uric acid in mind whenever you are dealing with a diabetic patient. But there are some stray reports telling that there is an inverse relationship between serum uric acid levels and diabetes mellitus, like the one which I have projected just now. And this is another one. This is closer to home. This is from actually Bangladesh. They say that serum uric acid levels were high in healthy individuals, but declined in pre-diabetic and diabetic individuals. Presently, there are difference in opinion about uric acid and onset of diabetes. Then coming to the recommendations, what our Indian Society of Nephrology has given for Indian patients and renal patients. For asymptomatic hyperuricemia, when it is more than 9, they should be treated with urate lowering drugs. So this is a recommendation from Indian Society of Nephrology. Don't ignore, even if they are asymptomatic, when the level is more than 9 milligram per deciliter. And with the level between 8 and 9, if there is comorbidities like diabetes, hypertension, ischemia disease, then you treat them, start using drug therapy. And patients more than 50 years, again, your threshold for treatment should be lower. Even when the level is more than 7 and when they have other comorbidities, better keep them with the drugs, especially if they have renal disease. And the drugs used, ISN recommends use of febuxostat over allopurinol because they think that allopurinol is more toxic and the risk of life threatening Stevens-Johnson syndrome is more in CKD patients. So that is the guideline from Indian Society of Nephrology. And this is a recommendation from a panel of Indian doctors. They say that serum uric acid should be tested in the routine evaluation of diabetes and other cardiovascular disease. And a value less than 6 milligram prevents kidney damage in a gout patient. So in a patient with hyperuricemia and gout, it is better to keep the value less than 6. And I already told you that in a flare-up situation, it can be spuriously low in the blood levels. And use urate lowering drugs in the lower doses as possible. Don't jump and use higher doses. And as a part of renal function test in CKD, uric acid is a must. And this panel has given equal marks for febuxostat and allopurinol. And the physician is supposed to use it case by case basis. And basis the principles which I think I have already alluded to, the levels and the drugs, and the selection between allopurinol and febuxostat is, in renal patients we prefer febuxostat, in otherwise it is left to the physician. And the agents available are allopurinol and febuxostat, and the safety regarding skin rashes, which can be terrible with allopurinol, is not there with febuxostat. And there have been now, this being a new drug, febuxostat, there are landmark studies which have shown that better efficacy than allopurinol in lowering uric acid. And the tolerability also. So what will be the take home message? See, there are lots of studies concerning uric acid and the possible links to hypertension, renal disease and cardiovascular disease. Diabetes, there is a question mark. But despite such evidence, it does not yet support the general treatment of asymptomatic hyperuricemia. You treat them only the situation which I alluded to in the previous slides, when they have comorbidities when they have problems. But CKD markedly increases the risk of hyperuricemia and gout, so it is better to treat them more than any general population. And also hyperuricemia, progression of CKD is more with hyperuricemia. So it is one of the main tools now, like using alkalizers, bicarb and hypouricemic drugs is a major tool we use in conservative management of CKD to retard progression of CKD. But globally, there is still scanty evidence regarding treatment of asymptomatic hyperuricemia. And I think we need to have more data, and we have to keep sharing knowledge to develop an Indian specific guideline for the management of hyperuricemia. And in the earlier population studies, I told you that asymptomatic hyperuricemia and the population within 2 standard deviation is much higher in people from East Asia. So the Japanese people, they are more aggressive in managing asymptomatic hyperuricemia, and they have their own algorithm. So asymptomatic hyperuricemia, even at the level of 7, they have given an algorithm where if they have any systemic involvement like gouty arthritis or typhus, they are taken straight for drug therapy. If they are absent and if the level is less than 7, again only lifestyle modification. If the level is more than 8, then you divide them into complications and other presence or absent of other metabolic problems. If present, you treat them or put them on lifestyle modification. So that is the Japanese thing. I think we have come to the end of the talk on hyperuricemia. But a slide on hypouricemia, because now and then when you are trying to check in an asymptomatic man, you may come across very low levels of uric acid, which is not common. But as a nephrologist, I come across sometimes in children when I'm trying to test them for, evaluate them for renal stone. So hyperuricemia, you'll have to keep in mind that it can happen due to some of the genetic problems. And xanthine, and they might have xanthineuria and stones due to xanthine. So just to remind you of that, let us not go into depth of all this. I think thank you. I have sort of try to give a brief overview of uric acid and the relationship to humanity, whether it is a villain or a good agent, and should we be really treating them, when to observe them, and how to deal with them. Thank you once again. I thank Abbott and people for having created this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for such a wonderful and interesting presentation and making us understand the burden of hyperuricemia. Especially, it was very interesting when you talked about the evolutionary aspect, like how, when from the evolutionary aspect, when man evolved, how this uric acid played in so many roles, and making us understand about the comorbidities associated with hyperuricemia, and making us understand previously it was a temporal association, now it may be a causative factor also, and making us understand in the asymptomatic hyperuricemia and the pharmacotherapy and the existing guidelines and the opinions from the Indian doctors. Yes, sir. Sir, here are a few questions to take up, so I will take them, sir. Sir, what is your stand on the management of hyperuricemia, especially in comorbid conditions? Is it mandatory when you see an asymptomatic hyperuricemic patient? Is it mandatory to evaluate for cardiovascular risk or kidney disease risk, sir?
Madam, as we were dealing with asymptomatic, the approach should be, see, anybody with asymptomatic hyperuricemia, you have a detailed history and see whether they have any possibility of situations where there can be hyperuricemia. The list I showed you, clinical situations and drugs, etc. And you'll have to see for the comorbidities, because the target levels vary with and without comorbidities. So we'll have to see whether they have diabetes, hypertension, ischemia, disease, etc. Because we have a lower threshold for treating them with drugs if they have these comorbidities. And sometimes, although they may not complain, they may have problems like renal stones and gouty, tophi, and all that. We might find them. So they'll have to be evaluated, if not extensively, by history and clinical exam and some investigations. And when they have these comorbidities, you have a lower threshold and treat them medically.
Sir, on the same note, like how long will be the follow-up for the uric acid if there is an asymptomatic patients, even with comorbidities or not? How long to follow up, or what will be the frequency for them to test the uric acid levels?
See, for a CKD patient and a renal patient, as I already told you, we have a tendency to treat most of them because it retards progression. So 3 monthly during the visits, we routinely see their serum bicarb and the uric acid along with urea creatinine, and we try to keep them low. But for a non-renal patient, the frequency, because these things don't change unless they are put on some situation where uric acid can rise or reduce. It is unlikely that keeps changing. So maybe yearly or every 6 months should be okay.
What is your recommendation on long-term monitoring, sir? Is it any special things is required on patient sites from patient profile, sir?
From the new onset metabolic diseases, see, as somebody ages, they are bound to get hypertension, ischemia, heart disease, diabetes, and chronic renal disease. So as they age, and as somebody's under your follow-up, we'll have to alter our frequency of testing and identify the uric acid level and treat them if necessary. So it should be an ongoing process. It is not like a one-time check uric acid and forget about it. Maybe at least once a year when they come for their annual checkup, you'll have to check uric acid. And as I was telling you, when trying to choose drugs for other diseases, keep the lists which I showed in mind and use it for the advantage of the patient, avoiding some drugs and selecting some other drugs.
What is the incidence of hyperuricemia, especially if it is asymptomatic? When we diagnose it, how often it is associated with comorbidities, at least in your practice, sir?
See, in renal patients, nearly 30% of them have high uric acid levels. So asymptomatically, they don't have any particular problem with uric acid, but many of them are showing higher levels. So we treat them. And as I told you, the population curve is so uneven that you have a mean of 7, but the standard deviation of 2 plus this side and that side, which is a wide variation. And there are people, you know, nearly 30% or 25% in East Asia who have high levels from the mean. And the general population, you know, the incidence of these metabolic disorders, and which is definitely higher in patients with high uric acid. That's what the population surveys have told. So, you know, so once you find hyperuricemia asymptomatic, then you keep looking for evolution of some of these metabolic diseases and comorbidity, which is yet to come.
Okay. We have understood this hyperuricemia is an imbalance between the overproduction and under-excretion. But 90% of the time, it is mostly due to under-excretion. So in this note, how far this lifestyle modification, especially a dietary recommendation, will be helpful? Is it like the patients follow the strict dietary restriction? Yeah. Will it be still helpful, sir?
Yeah, I talked about people who are taking very strict purine-free diet, they have found nearly 40% reduction in the uric acid levels, excretion. So that tells us that diet does have a role, but the normal diet of an average man may not have importance when I say this, because there are people who take eccentric food, like, you know, on a paleo diet. So now it is a very high fashion to take paleo diet for weight reduction. So they take plenty of meat, and this digestion of this meat will load the patient with a lot of purine, and uric acid will be definitely high. So I think in these modern times, especially with youngsters, and, you know, our dietary habits are very different from our older generation, diet advice will become very important, unlike in a naive, normal, regular patient. So these people is fast food and things, and they, and this fat for paleo diet. I think now I hear a little less than before, but some time ago, you know, people were, you know, falling over and taking this form of diet therapy for weight reduction, and they were in utter risk of raised uric acid and creatinine and progression of renal disease. So diet is an important thing which we should keep it in mind while advocating these patients. Although it is the the excretory element which is taking care of more than 70% of these patients.
Sir, do you practice dose titrations when there is a overcorrection for hyperuricemia? And yes. What if the tapering dose required when we are about to cure the patients?
Yeah, in my practice, what I do is, like, as per Indian Society of Nephrology, ISN recommendations, we prefer febuxostat over allopurinol. But whatever be the level, I don't jump and start with 80 milligram or 120 milligram, because there are people who show very good reduction even with lower dose. And our recommendation also tells us that we should be using the lower dose as possible. So I always start with 40, then follow them up. And very few patients only I require 80 or 120. And those are the patients, actually, we'll have to keep in mind the rare hyperuricemic state, where there could be some other genetic problem or other defects. And that should push us to, you know, investigate them further. But most of them do well with 40 or quarter of them with 80, and I do downgrade the dose if there is reduction, because now with this point I was telling you about the importance of uric acid in our body, it is not always bad. Uric acid is good to prevent neurodegenerative diseases, and all this stuff, I think it is not a good idea to bring them very low also. So you can't put a dose and forget about it, because if they go below 3, below 4, I think here on, I was also not very cognitive of this fact about relationship with neurodegeneration and intelligence and so on. So we should downsize the treatment and do not try to keep bring it very low, because now and then I see patients who are left on this drug therapy and they come back and you check after a long time their uric acid is 2 and lower. So I think we should avoid that.
Okay, sir. So then is there one question, in case of acute gout, when the normal, if it is a normal uric acid level in the patients of gout, but there has an acute flare, in this case, what to use? Is it allopurinol or steroids?
See, in a gout flare, I told you there is a spurious reduction in uric acid by our tests because there's profuse precipitation in the tissues, your uric acid pool is less. So it is very important to important not to ignore a low level and think that they do not, they have nothing to do with uric acid. But at the same time, other disease modifying drugs like steroids and other anti-inflammatory, etc., that is the one which is going to help them immediately. It is not the uric acid level. So it is equally important, first you treat them with the disease modifying and pain modifying, inflammation modifying substances, even before rushing to reduce the level.
Okay, sir. Thank you once again for the excellent presentation and making us clear of all our queries and taking us through the hyperuricemia. Sir, and on final note, what is your final advice on the uricemia for the practitioners and for the other practitioners?
Yes. See, uric acid as a substance, as I started the talk, I told you, is generally not feared about, is not much discussed about. So, it is there, and something like it was treated as a non-entity, but now we know that it has a definite use and it has a definite problem coming with uric acid. So we should maintain the balance and periodically check our patients and use drugs very judiciously and maintain the uric acid level. I think that should be the final thing I would like to do. We can't ignore uric acid. It should be part of the packages you do in our patients, like sugar, urea, creatinine, etc.
Sir, thank you once again for allotting your time in your busy schedule and sharing us the view. And it was very nice. And thank you every doctors for participating in the webinar. And in behalf of Abbott, I thank everyone. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Good day.
Thanks. Have a good day, sir.